The focus was as is, no more money. Rich, Anita, and I will go over the various methodologies and outcomes and discuss what changes are suggested as money availability increases.
Give them all that.
So we'll listen to what they have to say, but I'm still going to go over all my concerns with what they've presented so far. We'll see what their response to that is, and then we'll kind of go around the table. So, you know, with respect to your individual divisions, you know, patrol, robbery, you have the lead, records, investigation, and we'll go through their stuff. And then from a community perspective, I had Mikey Murphy, the crime analyst guy, go through their report. And what they're not saying in here is they're citing these things is that, for instance, the public bathrooms, San Diego put in two. They've removed one of the two already because of 130% increase in calls for service around that bathroom. The other one they've left in place for now because it only has an 81% increase in calls for service around that bathroom. Paliute that they cite in here for the homeless, you know, campments put out by the church. Their chief is speaking out against that and the increase in calls for service for vacancy threats. So they're all the things we would expect around something like that. So we'll talk to them about their lack of focus and looking at what the follow-up was rather than just some study that they used to put those things in place and not see what the effect has been since then. And I kind of, quite frankly, resent their accusation that we're criminalizing the homeless. What we're doing is holding them accountable for their misbehavior. So I'll cover a lot of that stuff, and then once we get into it, you guys can chime in. Obviously, Brian, I'm going to rely on you to go over, you know, statistical problems with their data, because for those of you that weren't here the other day, I had Brian's got a bachelor's degree in mathematics, although I tried to give him a master's degree. And Ed, I'll give you a copy of this. Four of the seven measurements that they're using to focus on this proactive time are actually estimates. They're not actual numbers that they derived from our information that we provided, and by adjusting their estimates by 5-10 minutes, you can see how much it throws off the percentages of their proactive time. And so I have some serious concerns that they did not do what they said that they were going to do and get. They told me they were going to get response times goals from council so that we can judge our staffing, ideal staffing, off of that. And they're not even looking at response times. They're not looking at geography. They're not looking at anything we said about emerging crime trends. They're not, you know, looking at response times to priority one calls for sworn staffing, priority two and three for sworn and non-sworn staffing and patrol. There's just a whole litany of things that it's like they just breezed over and didn't even pay attention to what we talked to them about. And I mean, their caseload numbers for investigations are just, they're one-third of what they actually are. So I don't even know where they got that data. They talk, their numbers aren't even accurate on scaling salaries. So we'll go through all that with them, and I'll kind of run through our list of concerns and then let them respond, and then we'll go by division and go around the table is what I think. So do you want to call in and we'll get this thing started?
It's not till 2 o'clock.
That part's
okay. They're not coming on until 2, so we have some time to talk about this. I forgot about that. Sorry. So I mean, they are suggesting that we go to a 10 plan, but the 10 plan that they have, we talked about this a little bit the other day, 50% of the department never sees a weekend off. There's better 10 plans than what are in here than what they're even discussing. And that's something, obviously, when we talk about 10 plans versus 12s, their 12s have 4 hours of embedded overtime a week, which costs a lot of money that they're not taking into account in here. What is it, 300 and something thousand a year?
Well, 2 hours a week, you know, for 60-some officers, it's $391,680 annually.
So they're not taking that into account, and they're also not taking the RPOA and the RPMA MOUs into account that we, you know, it's a negotiable item to change to a full straight 12 or, you know, some of these other, you know, shift plans or something we want to work with our unions with rather than just imposing things. So
hey,
there's some...
On that note, I brought up the bill's attention. If you go through the study, in our portion, they're advocating that we go to a 12-hour. If you go to the jail section, it's citing all these studies about why you should go to 12. So, I mean,
they're contradicting each other. Yeah, different study groups. I think they had work in jail versus police.
Why would they make suggestions in here that would cost us a lot of money and then turn around and tell you that this draft product was based on no new tax measure, so they only went to a specific point and stopped, yet the whole thing's laden with ways to improve our department that has a price tag attached to it?
I don't
understand that.
I don't understand a lot of it.
It seems contrary to me.
I really don't. I mean, even if you look at, you know, we need a lot of the things they say about Sage, we're already doing in Sage. Cintiff, because I had to look at dictation software in their discussion about going to this Dragonfly software. You have to train it to your own voice. So you've got to read 2,500 words into the thing before it's trained to you. Every person has to have their own license, which means it's got to sit on its own computer. And they're not taking all of those factors into account. I think they just got some wild hair idea, like I did, and said, hey, let's look at dictation software. Well, then when we really did the research, we found out it doesn't work. And, you know, Mary did medical dictation for years, and now they're going to that software. But now the girls that were dictating are now editors, because it doesn't get everything right. So they're making a lot of assumptions on how well things will work without actually having the practical knowledge of trying to apply it. And that's where I think that they have some serious problems. They're computing our corporals inaccurately into our patrol staffing. That's not what their job duties are. You know, we try to keep a supervisor on each side of the river, and the corporals are there to fill in on a beat if they absolutely have to. But the corporals are supervisors, and then they're equating this as part of the police officer total number to even get their proactive time. I just feel that these guys, in my opinion, thus far, and I don't know that they'll change that today, I feel like they were very disingenuous with us when they were meeting with us and talking about the things that they were going to do that just they didn't do. And they're basing all of the patrol staffing off of just one arbitrary 40% number for patrol proactive time, when they, in Richard Brady's own words, was a good community policing department has 60% proactive time. So there's just a whole lot of stuff that they're not taking into account. The day center, I talked to Jonathan, he's on his way, he's leaving a lunch meeting. Most of the duties that the day center does, or they're proposing, the Good News Rescue Mission already does. And most of the duties that they're assigning to these CSOs and police officers are social services jobs that we really, I don't think, want to take over from them. I very much, quite frankly, resent the fact that they're talking in here like the police department is criminalizing the homeless, when really what we're doing is holding them accountable for their poor behavior. And there is an entire theme to this thing, comparing us to LAPD, and that we're criminalizing the homeless. They're not. I don't like it at all. There's no talk of traffic or consideration of traffic. There's no discussion of the 29% crime increase that took place after AB 109 went into effect. So we're supposed to assume that that's the new norm. There's just a whole lot of things in here that I don't care for, and that I don't think they considered when they looked at patrol staffing. So.
Do you know what they're talking about or have been a part of this 2011-12 action plan?
I have no idea what that is.
Page 13, that's what they refer to.
Nobody seems to know what that is. I don't know what that is.
Is that the Department of Housing thing?
I think that's one, Brian.
That's a good job. Obviously, you probably know, but I would just ask them, just instead of telling how screwed up, ask them where they got this information, how they come to these numbers, and that might give us a better idea and readily identify why they're screwed up. Because if we just start telling how screwed up, they might say, oh, wait a minute, this is what we're basing on. Because I don't know what they're basing much of this stuff on. You know what I'm saying? I hope that they can explain that, because it's very, very difficult to even follow along with this.
I can. I mean, I can start that way. I was going to go through and give them all of my concerns and say, here's what I see based on what I read right now. It's very, very hard to follow. It's very, very poorly written. It looks like, quite frankly, you've cut and pasted out of a lot of things that you found but haven't done the secondary research to find out that those things have now been reversed. You know, you're citing cities that now have more vagrancy and, ordinances and things than other cities around them. You know, you're citing these toilets, and San Diego had these problems. So I really, Greg is trying to put lipstick on a pig here by saying, well, this is, in my opinion, hey, this was just based on your current, you know, staffing levels. But even at our current staffing levels, how can you say it's with no money when you're suggesting spending $500,000 on toilets and $750,000 on a homeless day center? So I don't, there's a lot of things in here suggesting that are MOU issues that we haven't even, you know, obviously we'd have to, you know, have negotiation and discussion with the RPOA and the RPMA to make some of those MOU issues and changes. But, you know, if you look at the simple job classification of the CSO, they can't go out and do enforcement like these guys are suggesting, and quite frankly, they won't. So there's a lot of issues there, and I think that, you know, quite frankly, I think that if these guys did present this study in its current form at a city council meeting, I think, you know, Bob Blankenship said, if it's that ludicrous, just sit back and let the citizens take care of it. And I think that there would be, and if they published this before they presented it at a council meeting and let people see the approach that they're trying to tell us to take, I think that, that there would be a lot of business people and community people there screaming louder than the police chief were. I think one's sitting to my right, quite frankly.
Well, you know, just a couple of comments. I, you know, when I was being interviewed by this guy, one of the questions I asked him was who were the people he was talking to. And I honestly don't think they picked enough names out there of the community at large to talk to that would have given him honest answers. I suggested a couple of people when he was talking to me just because they weren't on his list. And, you know, when you read this thing, just from a layman's standpoint, you know, I have to cut through all the percentages and all that stuff, and I got to take it that you guys have already put all that, you know, you've taken that into consideration. That's, you know more about that than I do. But they missed the mark on a couple of things, and I think the thing that stands out the most is when they start including the homeless in the criminal issue, that's wrong. And unfortunately, you know, 3 or 4 years ago when we came together as a community and started doing a lot of meetings through the Crime Watch or whatever groups out there that have had their meetings, we used the term homeless, and we didn't understand the definition of it. Now, I'm not sure that they do. I'm not sure that they define the difference between, there were a couple of things in there where they talked about panhandling and transients and all that stuff, but it was limited. And really and truly, those are the people that are my concern. They're not the homeless. The homeless are the guys that, you know, the wants?
Yeah.
Those are the wants, the people that we,
the one helping you
need to take care of, and Jonathan works with them, and we hopefully make their lives better. They threw that in there, and I think that should have been a totally different section all of its own. It doesn't have anything to do with you guys. You guys are the ones dealing with, you know, the guys on the street that are walking around with backpacks and riding the bikes. Those aren't homeless people. Those are thieves. They're people that are out there doing no good. And I just don't get how they didn't pick up on that. I know they rode around with a lot of guys, you know, a lot of different officers. They had to have seen that. You know, and I get the impression maybe that they got a couple people chirped in their ear that had issues with how that was being dealt with. But, gosh, it just seems like they didn't go out and talk to enough people that really see the thing as it really is for our community. It just doesn't, it's not a good picture of it.
That's a good point. And to the ride-along part, I don't think any of them that were involved in this did a ride-along, mm-hmm. except for one guy.
One guy did two ride-alongs.
That's
so one it. Guy did two. Yeah, within the first 5 minutes that they were here, they did.
That's it.
The other guy that was supposed to do, he canceled.
Shoot, they should have done a dozen ride-alongs just to see what goes on in the city, different hours.
That's huge to go on two ride-alongs. And they come up with hard numbers on how long it takes to write police reports,
uh-huh. mm-hmm.
how long it's been here and there, and just guess.
Another thing that they do throughout the report is they refer to them as displaced. Mm-hmm. That artificially inflates the numbers, because you could have somebody that is employed, has a family, their credit is so screwed that they can't rent a house. They live in apartments. They're not homeless.
Right.
But now you lump them into displaced, and now you're inflating your numbers. So I got a problem with
that. Well, yeah, displaced would suggest that they're here for some reasons beyond their control. Yeah. And a lot of them are here.
Displaced people.
Yeah, exactly. It's, are they displaced? Are they transient? Are they homeless? Are they urban campers? What is it? But the displaced persons, that's what he refers to them most of the time. And I think a lot of them that I contact every day are here by choice.
Well, you know, you take this thing, it's this thick, your portion of it. You take out the homeless stuff, it's probably only about that thick, you know, the real data, the real life, you know, real things that are going on out there. And I just don't think they spend enough time. Personally, to me, that's the biggest issue in our community today. And really, it gets the smallest amount of attention. Something's wrong there.
I didn't know what you said because I had to go to Jonathan because he's late. So, as far as format with these guys, and we got about 40 minutes, what do you guys think? Do you think I should let them start off describing their methodologies and stuff to the group, or should I
that's
ask them how they came up with it, or should I just punch them in the notes?
He pretty much gave you the excuse right there in his email. That's what he's trying to pull back on.
But even then, I mean, I agree with Koby. I mean, you're telling us to spend money, but you're saying this is based on existing funding.
Well, that's what I'm saying. I think he's just trying to cover his butt right there.
Well, Kurt had a discussion Friday with Richard Brady, and Kurt basically told him that reading the report, he was very underwhelmed, that they need to hire an editor, because when you pay $150,000 for a report, it shouldn't be wrought with, you know, grammar and typos and everything else. He didn't do anything with any of the future funding. He says they're going to describe to us what they think the police department should get with future funding. But I don't know. He also told him you have a very unhappy police chief. So we'll see how they come into this. But he also said that Richard Brady stood pretty firm on his analysis of patrol. And I completely disagree with him. If he's going to say that we're good, he obviously has no experience in policing whatsoever and shouldn't even be doing any studies, because I disagree 100% when you, I mean, they're using a national standard and average for fire, but they're not doing that for police. And I did the math this morning. If you base it on 90,000 at the national average of 1.8, we should be at 162 sworn, and we're sitting at 102. So, you know, I just don't see rearranging a shift schedule being something that's going to fix the problems. And what they were asked to do was do a staff study on what, you know, here's unlimited funding, here's what the police department should be, and I don't see any of that.
Weren't they
incrementally?
Weren't they asked to look at it from a standpoint? God. Church chair. Weren't they asked to look at this from, and if we had a 0.25% increase, a 0.5% increase, 0.75%, 4%, weren't they asked to study that?
Yes, Kurt talked to him about that too, and told him that's not in here. So that may be what they're going to talk about today, but still, it should be, here's ideal staffing for the police department, but if you had 5, 10, 15, or 20 million, here's how we would suggest you spend money, you know, citywide.
And maybe that's where they got on page 5, they put $5, $10, and $15 in revenue attachment. But they don't say, what is that?
$5, $10, $15.
What does that mean? Is that a sales tax? Is that cross-reference to tier 1, tier 2, tier 3? What does that have to... Nothing is cross-referenced.
Well, they reference it in the executive summary, but then they never touch on it again. And that's what Kurt...
Because it's pasted from some other reports.
That's where Kurt hit him on the other day.
And that's the comment that, you know, the people that I know that have read this, they're like, it's a cut-and-paste draft. And it's just, yeah.
So, well, I've got everybody's consolidated list here of their comments, and then I have this... you know, analysis of it where, like you said, Mike Murphy actually went on every point they made for the homelessness, went back to those cities and found reports that came out after the study that they're using that basically had they either reversed what they're doing or they're about to reverse what they're doing because of the major problems that they've been having. So Mikey did a really good job. I mean, this is from the Portland paper talking about the maintenance costs and what San Diego's done to remove them and how much money they're costing and how many problems they're causing and calls for service around things that they,
You can do a quick Google search of Palo Alto and it sees, you know, exactly what's happening because they've allowed people to live in their vehicles in the city. Now they're complaining about it because they have people urinating everywhere and causing homeless, I mean, disturbances. And also now it's coming up again.
So I will tell them that, that in the end, you know, we'll take this consolidated list of comments and send it to them and go through. They can go through and look at all of these. So, Brad, what do you got? Anything?
I think you guys covered it very well.
Brian?
Nothing new.
Koby?
Well, I share the same concerns that Eric has. I think if we open this up and just lambast them with all these things that we think are erroneous, that he's just going to shut down. But if we say, you know, this report is not only a huge surprise to us, but we're really disappointed in it because clearly the city is not happy with the nature of how things are going. And your suggestion that the police department not change in terms of staffing is not going to do anything to address these concerns. But the thing about this in my mind that sticks with me the most is this. I think you can come up with a bunch of different statistics to support your study. And like Jeff said, statistics can be the greatest liar. But what people are bothered with now is the feeling that the city is dirty and unsafe. And those feelings are never captured in statistics. And frankly, there's probably a lot of things that these homeless people do every day that never gets reported to us. So why I say that is because the best way to take care of that sentiment is to get out in front of that kind of crime, which we don't do anymore. And that's something that we prided ourselves in doing as a police department all through the late 80s and all through the 90s, was we had a reputation for being extremely proactive. And we got out ahead of crime. And there's nowhere in this study that would allow for us to go back to those times. And a lot of people will point to those times and say, Reading was at its best when we were partnering with crime-free housing. We were at schools. Butch was doing some stuff at that place over on Trinity Street where you were with these at-risk latchkey kids and you were just getting together with kids and helping become, you know, mentors to them and getting them involved in programs that would never allow them to have that idle time. And the list goes on. We had little NPU offices in different parts of the city, wherever there were hot spots, and this doesn't allow for any of that.
It actually steers you away from that. The broken window.
It really.
They said, don't do that anymore.
It really is going on.
They're not crimes.
And so, while I take exceptions with the numbers, if you just go off this, and you're going to add a couple CSOs to be the liaison to homeless people, and what else? You need to be more transparent, talk more with the community, and, you know, show them what we're doing, and then give them progress reports. That's really it for me. That's really what I'm left with from this.
Well, they said the chief needs to connect with more groups. I'm not sure what other group in town I haven't spoke with already.
Yeah, you've made yourself available more than most chiefs have here. So I don't understand that at all. But beyond all that, this doesn't allow for us to go back to those glory days when we had enough people to do proactive police work. The only people that are doing that now are, you know, probation, parole, gang unit, and that's not as often as it once was. And maybe somebody in the wee hours of the morning between, say, 2:45 and 7.
Mm-hmm.
That's it. That's your proactive time now.
You know, Koby, you hit on something that I don't think that the entire public really understands. You know, they start talking about the revolving door at the jail, and the comments will be, well, why do you want to hire more cops if you can't put them in jail? Well, the reality of it is we're going back to what you just said we used to be. And I think that really and truly is what most people that have been here for a long period of time, that's what they want for this community. And I don't know, again, I go back to these guys not talking to the right people, because I think if they would have talked to the right people, they would have heard that. You know, I'm a firm believer that if we get
bodies out there that push some of these people we don't want to be in this community around a little bit, it doesn't matter whether we put them in jail or not, they're going to move on. They're going to stop doing the things they do down by Black Bear Diner and Circle K and 99 Cent Store. Now they're moving over into that Lowe's parking lot. You know, they're there all the time now because nobody's pushing them around. You know, nobody's saying anything to them because you guys don't have time. And when I go out on my property and do it, I get them off. But, you know, the other guy, I might not get the same one back every day, but I'll get a new one tomorrow just because there's so many of them. There's just, and they're everywhere, you know.
Well, someone had suggested it's like they weren't listening to us because I spent an hour and a half with that guy. I said, let me tell you what my memory is of this department, how it once was and how it is now. When we had a full complement of CSOs and our response times were like 4 minutes, you know. Let me tell you how it was and how it is now. This is what we would like to get back to. In fact, we jokingly said, you know, this chief isn't asking for much. He just wants to be back to where we were. And no, don't give us any extra. Yeah. Get us back to the levels we were in the early to mid-90s. We would be really happy about that. But it's almost like they weren't listening. There's nothing in here that addresses ways to get back to where we were.
Because I did talk about the history, just like you're saying, you know, what it was like, you know. I'm one of the few people probably they talk to that can remember that.
Yeah.
You know, because, in all frankly, I guess I just don't think they talk to the right people. I just think that's...
And the people they did talk to, I don't think they listened.
You missed them being disingenuous. And like Toby said, you know, you sit down with this guy for an hour and a half, and then they want to know what they should be looking at to get a feel of our community. And, you know, they're so heavy on the one, looking at cab reports that they apparently didn't understand anyway because they never got back with you to understand those. But, you know, I talked to them about what happened with our community where people, maybe a lot of it's not reportable stuff, but the feeling, the overall sense of crime that's in our neighborhoods and our communities and our stores and everything else. So go and talk to all these big major box retailers that now have, you know, security guards stand at the front doors in uniform. You didn't have that 5 years ago. Now every store you patronize has security standing there because they're getting rifled with crime every single day. Oh yeah, I'm just taking notes. We'll go and talk to all those people. And I'm getting a laundry list of those businesses. None of that's mentioned. They didn't follow up on any of those kind of things that we talked about.
They clearly see all of the transients and homeless as victims, and that's the way this is.
That's a good point.
And our issue is the ones we deal with are criminals.
Well, and that's one of the things that frustrates me about this is that it's, you know, they talk directly about criminalization of the homeless, and they compare us to LAPD, you know, and those types of things, when really what we're doing is we're holding criminal transients accountable for their actions. You know, if you're going to steal, if you're going to urinate in public, if you're going to go drink in the parks, I'm sorry, but that's not criminalizing them, it's holding them accountable. And there are resources for them to go to here, and I agree with what Jonathan said the other day. You know, what they're saying this day center should do, they already do. But we can't get this population to want to go. And that's where this wide-eyed, idealistic view that they're bringing here obviously shows me they have never driven a patrol car because that population just does not want to go there and they won't go.
People that want to get help that are truly destitute, Jonathan and crew helps them, right? These are the people that want to get a job, want to get educated, want to get help. There's help out there for them.
Mm-hmm.
These other folks don't want it and they choose a lifestyle.
And we have to have discretionary time to address big problems. We just do. We encourage the officers to open these POP projects and that's the expectation. And they do that, I think partly because it's expected, but also because they want to do that. But to do it right, you have to have discretionary time. The only way to have discretionary time is to have more people. How can you create that by putting more overtime on the hallway for officers to fill vacancies with a different shift schedule? All that's doing is plugging holes on the shift to just field calls for service.
Well, and I told Greg, you know, we can't necessarily shift staffing to the busier times because I can't leave three guys on graveyard to cover 60 square miles. I'm not the sheriff. You know, I got to make sure that the people, there's a safety factor that comes into this as well, that we've been skirting on for a long time. And quite frankly, we've got pretty lucky, you know, that with the drive time, I'd hate to have one of our officers on a fight at the boat ramp on Bonnie View and the only cop available just cleared TROs. You know, that's a long time to be in a fight by yourself.
We could have, you know, the chief could ask us to, you know, focus on whatever, cell phone tickets, you know, cell phone violations or seatbelt tickets, and ask the whole shift to do that. And in between their calls for service, you might get one or two or three tickets at the end of a 10-hour shift. You put one or two guys out on a grant-funded operation like that, and they'll do more than the entire department in a few hours. And that's what I'm talking about. If you can get people away from the servicing the community's call for service and let them focus in on a problem, you get tremendous results. And there's nowhere in this report that allows for that.
Well, did I misread the way the report said it too, that you know, it was talking about the number of officers that you have out at any one given time, which is usually somewhere between, you know, 14 to 16 officers is what I get.
Seven if it's one shift, seven to nine if you count.
No, but I mean if guys are hurt and stuff, if they're not.
No, we have a minimum shift of seven officers, and then we have a supervisor per shift. So when there's an overlap, then we have, you know, upwards of 14, but that's only for, you know, a certain portion of the day. It's, you know, at night.
I'm talking about total staffing to that 102 level that you're talking about. They wanted to include the 16 officers that are always hurt. They said if they're there,
correct,
then, you know, we're putting it back into the thing. And I'm like, well, they're always going to have that many.
Exactly. So they included those. They included our corporal.
Right, to get to the level they wanted.
They included the seven in training. They included all those in a perfect world of, you know, having all those hit the streets.
So that's just, well, they also say we have a chronic vacancy problem, and I take exception to that because, you know, we have a chronic injury problem, but we don't have a chronic vacancy problem. I mean, we hire people as fast as openings come up. I got one vacancy right now, and I got two anticipated in December, and we've already got three in background. So as soon as those guys retire in December, we'll fill those two spots right away. So, you know, I don't know whether they're talking about it with respect to injury. Well, then call it a chronic injury problem, because vacancies are unhired positions, and we don't have a problem with that. Just because we've hired 35 people, you know, in 3.5 years that I've been chief, doesn't mean we've had vacancies for long periods of time. Except for injuries and other issues waiting for discipline proceedings to take place. But
and also, we're losing technically four positions in a year and a half. Right? So those four positions we just got are gone.
So these
don't,
four,
they don't add those in and say, hey, by the way, anticipate four officers leaving in a year and a half, because that's just going to happen.
They basically granted themselves four police officer positions out of the reserve for 2 years. But if the budget doesn't grow, those four new positions go away.
Chief, one thing I want to say is we've had two, three people who are not part of this police department that all concur with our opinions on this. And I don't know what other people like Kurt have shared with you, but the fact that nobody that I've talked to says, oh, you're all wet on this and here's why, makes me think this is a bad product. Nobody within our group is arguing the merits of this in their favor.
Well, realistically, even if you look at this, to me, this looks like a very homeless-oriented report and a very social service-oriented report. And quite frankly, not even the guy that runs the homeless mission agrees with the report. So, but there's other people that have looked at it, too. I haven't got any feedback from Jason or Dennis as of yet. Dennis was in here the other day and hadn't had a chance to go through the whole thing yet.
Is it possible that someone outside of this group or outside of the police department has influenced this report to end this way that we wouldn't know about? Because it's almost...
Obviously talked to somebody in the homeless.
Part of this on the county side is HHSA. And here's what I will tell you. There was a email sent out on an event that Vasenko's holding, and one of the HHSA... staff sent an email to SCAR, which he overlooked the fact that Captain Moore is on the SCAR board, saying, well, maybe we can ask the sheriff about the criminalization of the homeless as well. So Basenko's already screamed at him, screamed at his supervisor, and is just waiting for Danelle Ewart to get back, because that's a staff member of County HHSA saying things like that, that law enforcement is criminalizing the homeless. So, and the HHSA and mental health is part of the county's portion of this report that's not in here. So, I don't know. I don't know where they got this. They were asked to look at police. They were asked to look at fire, jail, and mental health. This whole thing looks like they were asked to do a study on homelessness. And I think they missed the focus, quite frankly. Mary, Joe Sadowski's out there. We didn't cancel my meeting with him today. Can you go tell him I'm sorry? And that I'll give him a call this afternoon or see if we can link up with him tomorrow.
Is he downstairs or up?
He's out here waiting for me to open the door.
Oops. He can handle it.
Smoking Joe Sadowski. So I'm real pleased with the amount of time and effort everybody's put into, you know, going through this in detail, and we got a lot of very good feedback by page, and I'm probably just going to email this whole list to them of things so that they can look at it and say, ooh, yeah, because I'll tell you what, on all the homeless stuff, old Mike Murphy, man, he took him to task. He did a really good job of, like Brian did, of going through the numbers. Mike did it on all their lack of citation of studies and studies that came after, or results that came after the implementation study that they're citing. So that'll be maybe good for them to read. But I think we've got about 20 minutes before they get on the line. So
I guess one more thought.
Oh, okay. Let's see how is Mary bringing it?
The message I got from this whole report was that your crime problem and your homeless problem and your transient problem is here, and there's nothing that you can do about it. I think that I agree with Ed, is that they did not take into account the community that we have, because this is not Portland. This is not Seattle. The people here don't want Portland or Seattle. They didn't take that into account. I think that they're expecting for the community to look to read this and go, oh yeah, this is exactly what we want. That's not what they want. And if the message of this is what you have is inevitable and there's nothing you can do about it, I don't think the public is going to swallow that at all. They're going to shove it right back in their face. That's what I think. Because it's just not reflective of the attitude of this city. It's just not.
But I don't think they did this to cater to community. When I talk to the guy, he goes, hey, the numbers are going to speak for themselves. We're going to look at
it. That's not what the report says.
I see this as really slandering almost a biased way towards kind of interjecting their thoughts on the homelessness and how they should be dealt with. And kind of use bits and pieces and parts and slivers of studies to kind of bolster that.
I think they listen to HHSA a lot and some of the folks over there. But
somebody got
somebody
know that they've done
their or that's their own.
But they've also done similar studies in very liberal areas and probably got a way different response than what they're getting from us. They probably got, oh yeah, that's exactly what we need, and it's not what
they mentioned Portland, and if you remember, Pete, that very first meeting we came to our staff meeting and said Portland thought they had a big disparity in the workload and the number of people they had, and we proved they didn't. And they were very unhappy with that. So they're maybe used to this. And I know Bill and I looked at several of them from back east where the police department were extremely unhappy with their work product.
Aaron Murray just pulled up a survey today and saw the same thing. He was reading one. They did the same thing.
This may not be new to him.
Yeah, this is what they do, I think.
You know, Portland, in fact, was one of them that wasn't happy with their own.
Portland, Hanford, Connecticut, I think. Maine or Maine. You know, here's the only thing we can do. And Kirk told him, hey, your numbers are your numbers. We asked you to do this assessment. We're not going to tell you or dictate to you that you're going to change it. The only thing that I can do is give them our feedback today. If they insist on keeping it this way, then when they present this to council, then I'll present this. And that's all of our, you've got wrong numbers here. You're doing this wrong. Your case numbers. I mean, they're showing you with, what, 8 cases per investigator, and you've got like 27?
some cases.
Yeah, so, you know, right there, based on their own ratio, you said, what, it should be 18 or 20 investigations instead of 9?
It's way more.
Yeah, so, you know, we'll just point that out to them, and we'll point it out to council. And really, I'll say what I said the other day, is that, you know, it's a very simple question for me to council. If you want to believe this or you want to believe the police department's assessment, do you feel the public safety is better today than before you cut the police department? Kind of going back to what Koby and Ed were talking about. Do you feel it's better today than before? And if your answer is no, then you might want to listen to your police department.
And you focus on, you mentioned with Pete, just on open cases. How many cases touch your hand throughout the day?
I've got a stack of 100 right now.
They'll go through them, they'll deactivate, or, you know, they'll hold them and, or close them, keep some of them open. And it's not just their open cases they're working, they're going through
That's
open
right.
cases.
I think one thing we have to demand out of them is to get a national average in there, just like they refuse to do it. Yeah, they said they refused.
Yeah, because I talked to them about that originally. You know, 1.6 to 1.8 officers per 1,000, but if you look at the national average for cities between 50 and 99,000, it's 1.8 officers per 1,000. He said, we don't use any of that because it's just too arbitrary.
But they do it for the fire department.
Yeah, they use the national standard for fire departments.
We need to push them on that.
But here, you're using an arbitrary number like proactive time as the only measure of patrol staffing.
If we
That's force
them to do the national average, that'll be our proof right there.
The national average would put us at 162, if you use the bedtime population, not the daytime swell that we get. But realistically, even that, I mean, if you want to do an analysis outside of that, then you have to look at what is the goal for priority one response time? What is the goal for priority two and priority three response times? That gives you, you know, how many CSOs you're going to need, how many officers you're going to need. You have to look at the geography of the city. They don't take traffic into account. They don't take emergency crime trends with prostitution and heroin. Jeff had a long conversation, Pete did with him, about heroin and how bad it's coming into this community and how we need more drug enforcement because five guys for the county just isn't enough. And when we talk about five guys, now I think it's six because I think Anderson put a guy out there, but still, six guys working drug enforcement. We're not talking about the city of Reading. We're talking about Shasta County. There's six guys.
And they didn't even really address that.
No.
In any detail.
No, so you mentioned them, and
just like traffic, it's just like trying to work.
You know, we pulled, what, 2 16-year-olds out of the bed in the last month? You know, because they don't talk about the prostitution problem. We talked to them about Reading Backpage and all the, it just, I don't think they listened to anything.
What they said about Sage, somebody there was saying they were flexible.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Just
Sage works
in
multiple different things, but
they call me
flexible.
I didn't get that.
That was a question
mark. If we're paying them this bill, and we tell them to put the national average in compared to where we're at, they should be putting it in before paying them.
What's that?
Sorry.
If we're paying their bill, and we tell them to put the national average in, they should put it in.
The city manager doesn't, otherwise, why hire a consultant? So his point is give them the feedback. But their analysis is their analysis. And if that's their analysis, then we're going to do our own.
They can stay with their analysis, but they need to know the national average.
I'll do that.
Are the fire in the county as bad, too?
No, fire is, I think, an increase of 9 or 12 firemen to get them to the national standard. But there's no national standard address for the police department. So apparently there's no crime in the city's burning down. But, you know, I'm not going to fight with the fire guys, you know. Not having three guys on a fire truck means they have to sit out front and spray water. They can't make entry into a fire because California OSHA standard, you have to have two guys on a hose to make entry into a fire. And if that's my house burning down, I want them to go into that. So I'm not going to argue and fight against our own fire department. But the fact that you're using a national standard for them but not using a national average for us just is, they didn't do any of the analysis on staffing that they said that they were going to do for us. They didn't take response times into account. They didn't take geography. They didn't take so many things into account when judging. He told me, and I quote, what is your standard emergency response time set by council? What's your goal response time? I said, I don't have one. He said, well, we need to get them to set one because that plays into how many officers you have to meet that. But yet, where is that analysis? It's not in there. The whole thing for patrol is based on this random proactive time that they're going to fix just by changing shifts.
I just think that's an unfair question to begin with. The response time should be whatever it takes to keep the community safe. That's what it should be. I mean, how could you expect someone to go, oh, we would like an average response time of 8 minutes? Okay. So you would like the officer to take 8 minutes to get to you and someone's booted your door in and is killing or maiming one of your family members?
Yeah, but if you did 8 minutes for us, that means you have to double patrol. Because yeah. Right now we're at 16.
That's why it's not a fair question. It's a political question that's going to have money and all kinds of other considerations mm-hmm. attached
Absolutely
to it.
Absolutely it is, but that's what council's elected to do. So realistically, when I handed him the as I've called it, Rob's La La Land, now I call it Rob and Kobe's La La Land because he helped me put it together and he's just as much to blame. You know, we came up with 174 sworn and 26 CSOs. He said, yeah, Chief, but that's based on the service level you think you want to give this community, not what council expects. Well, I guess I'm just a dummy that doesn't know what the hell he's doing. So, you know, the way I put that together when Koby and I think Roger was in there, is we started with, this is the officers we need in these positions. And then we built the leadership over the top of that. I think we had all the lieutenants in there when we did that. And we built the leadership from the bottom up. Here's what we need from officers and CSOs to service the community, and here's the leadership it takes to run that organization, and that's how we got to that number, rather than just some arbitrary statistic. You know, I'm sorry, but we need a street crimes unit to do exactly what Ed talked about. You can call it neighborhood police unit, you can call it street crimes, whatever, but they need to be out doing spotting missions for dope. They need to be, I hate to use the term because it sounds offensive, but in-your-face policing, where every time one of these guys turns around, it's, hi, I'm Officer So-and-so, what you doing today? You know, every single time, because that is a deterrent to crime. You know, we need double the people in patrol, two officers and a CSO per beat for days and swings, and then one car per on the graveyard shift, but it needs to be a two-person car for the officer's safety.
I'd like to know where the arbitrary numbers come up. You know, the 35% to 50%. You know, they won't use the national average because they say it's not supported by any kind
where
of
where do you come up with this?
But you come up with these arbitrary numbers with no litmus test on how you got to say 40% is where you need to be for proactive time. So all these, and it goes right along hand in hand with their 4 out of 7 points that they're using for
our estimates.
For estimates, it's just haphazard.
Yeah, I don't.
I spoke with Mike Dahl, who was sitting on with the group for the fire department, and he wrote an email back and copied me on it, and I thought he had some really good points in there. And the point that made the most sense to me when you start talking about fire police is, you know, they asked for these, I think it was 12 positions that they said they needed for fire to be able to get a 3-man engine all the time. But the comment back was, how often do the fire department people go out on calls for automobile accidents and RPD can't respond and they end up having to do some of the work there? You know, that's not even really addressed back in the police portion. It should have been, gosh, if they're not able to get to an accident, they should be able to get to an accident. And they're causing, you know, fire to have to deal with this problem. And, you know, that very well could equate to 12 officers for the police department that we're not even looking at. I just, you know, it just, every time you turn a corner on this thing, there's just lack of information and lack of standardization, lack of, you know, they just weren't thorough. You know, typical consultant, I've dealt with consultants many times throughout my life. And, you know, the one thing that I always remember somebody told me years ago is a consultant's the guy that takes your wristwatch and tells you what time it is. And, you know, unfortunately, they didn't listen very well. And so they didn't do a very good job. So
they ain't looking at my watch.
I don't, you know.
My watch got a whole different time than that.
Somebody's watching. It wasn't anybody in this room, probably. So.
All right, well, we've got 9 minutes till they'll be on the line, so everybody kind of take a break for a minute while Bill gets all that set up, and then we'll start. If any of the guests that don't have keys need to use the restroom or anything, let me know, and we'll give you out to get to one.
Hey, I think it's important that they hear your opinion out here loud as a community member, business owner. You know, here's what I've read. Here's what I don't agree with. And I don't think the rest of the community is going to agree with it either. You know, that's how much.
I think if they present this at a council meeting, I think they better run to their cars.
This is a very...
You're going to get two sides to that. You're going to get that group over there. And unfortunately, it's a more vocal group.
And they're going to go, see, I told you we didn't need more cops. Mm-hmm. You know, they're dealing with the homeless incorrectly. That's what I'm afraid of.
No, I'm afraid of that, too.
I'd love it if it was the other, you know, group that said, yes, we need more cops on the street. You know, that's the one you want. But unfortunately, I think there's a chance that other group could take this and...
Yeah. So what do you think about that? I mean,
I don't know what they're going to do.
Personally, the whole base and everything, I think it's just...
Guarantee I'll be there first.
Because that's what the mission is, you know? I think I'm right on with everything that Heston is saying. Dead on.
Hey, Dennis. Hi, Rob. How are you? I'm good. How are you? Pretty good.
I spoke with them today.
Today they got their sonogram. Last week. How's your wife? She wanted to love your house another 50.
No, I think she's about ready to pull it.
It's going to expire. She would let it expire.
What's that?
It's going to expire. She would let it expire.
13th. She's very young. She had John something on the masonry out there.
I don't know. I think.
Saturday?
He probably had this.
Talk to him about...
They don't. They have much.
Rock pillars. Either a vertical gate or a sliding gate across the front because the dogs push that little piece of crap over.
We didn't have that. Oh, clear out to the street.
Trenching an electrical. I want to trench an electrical line out there because the damn solar things don't work in the winter.
I'm already in a
wrought iron gate so the dogs can't push it over. And then
this should be a...
We're going to probably get ourselves going to put the white fencing along the front because of our measures. So we have a nice looking front entry.
Stunned by your findings.
All these improvements now.
They don't come over.
We have...
I was okay with it. I'm not going to take some low ball value, not get anything out of it. I have to come to town and have the same type mortgage.
Well, somebody just asked me.
What did you base it?
Well, really
where? You know, I really comped it about 7.23. So I said I can't.
Where is that?
Well, yeah, because we don't have that many people looking at those price ranges. And I said, well, he realizes that. She said, so to keep lowering it doesn't necessarily mean it's going to bring that buyer because they're not looking for it.
Yep. I agree. So she said, okay, but if we're going to stay, we're going to start
and I'm not
taking on project at the time. I said, that's fine. Credit card paid.
That's been happening to that.
Trucks running fine.
I'm really more.
Cars running fine. So we'll take them off and, you know, $10,000
counts. Not to go in our favor. That's not
so that's what, which is what I think.
No. Just crap.
She thinks about 8. I think it'll get up to 10 by the time you do the stone masonry on the outside of the pillars. And, I don't know whether we got to, I got to get signature. Fencing or gates is who he recommended, the mason guy. Whether it'd be better to put in a sliding gate or a lift gate. Because the sliding gates, if you get the gravel in there, then it throws the gate off, and the lift gate might just be. But as long as it doesn't move this way, swing gates, I'm afraid the dome is just going to, he just pushes me, walks his way through, he's a moron. I need one that he pushes on and it goes like this.
Yeah, you get all that time.
That dog's an idiot.
Well, it's not like this happens.
Just don't stand up.
90% of people we all next to you squat down.
That's not the kind of gate I have that I have to get out of that lot every single time. Do it myself.
No, it doesn't sound like it.
Oh.
I went to a call down off the rest of the hour. Like, I think I was still in Shasta County out there. And to get to this house, you get to a community gate. Well, there's no gate pad, there's nothing. And I'm looking at the house, and I can see it from where I'm standing. And I thought, it's a hot day. I'm not going to jump over this fence, and I'm not going to climb down
under it.
Go back up. About this time, this car comes up, and he goes, oh, are you here for your mom? It's my mom's house. I said, how do you open the gate? She goes, oh, she had to open the guardrail, lean out off the bridge, and push a button on the back side of the fence. I said, that's how you get in and out?
Every single time.
Unless you have... You're a homeowner, you get all the remote for it. Like,
Yeah, and you're supposed to know that.
I'm looking at the house right now.
Is anybody dying inside?
October. My daughter was born the third week of October.
Can you imagine on the workman's comp form?
How did you get injured?
I was doing my gymnastics, trying to get in the gate.
Fell off.
Yeah, I wish you wanted to go.
I had one.
Thank you for handling that.
What's that called, the, like, invisible?
Sure.
Why didn't you call Joe Sadowski this morning?
I went over to DM Taylor's house, we were going to go, and I was looking at his backyard, showing me the stuff he's done, and I set my phone just, I was holding like this, and all of a sudden it's on the ground. It dropped face down on his rocks, on his river rocks, and I looked up, it was right at the screen, it was shattered, and I just got the phone. Well, then I peeled this thing back, and the other screen was perfect. Just the invisible shield. Didn't do any of the other.
So it's worth the $20.
Totally worth it.
It is. I had the same thing, and I thought it was broken. I was taking it back.
Pull it back?
Yep.
It works good.
It does. I didn't have one before, and it didn't.
Yeah. The name of the company, they have one of those industrial grade cases for your phone that shows this guy. He's standing up like a, I don't know, little freeway. There's a lot of snow on the ground. It's probably 75 yards from where he was at down the freeway. He throws it as hard as he can. And just like I said, probably 75 to 100 yards by the time it finally got done hitting to the bottom. Wiped off the snow, made a phone call.
You're the one that covered the whole thing.
$100 for the case.
Yeah.
All right, Bill. Are we just about ready?
Call these guys.
Well, I haven't used the water bottle. I don't think you'll.
No.
I don't think you'll suck off my ball, my water bottle.
Into your hat.
Probably not.
Okay, here we go. Game faces.
You are the first person to join the meeting. Please stand by.
Okay, I'll mute it until they come on.
I think you should turn this off.